I'd forgotten how much I hate space travel.
Try and hold them off. Angle the deflector shield while I make the calculations for the jump to light speed.
Stay sharp. There's two more coming in. They're going to try and cut us off.
Rebel order. Standing by.
Watch your mouth, kid. You're going to find yourself floating home.
Hey, baby. Hold again.
Both
strap yourselves in. I'm going to make a jump to light speed. Welcome to a brand new episode of the Rebel Order Podcast, a all Star Wars podcast brought to you by the Boomcast family. And I am Dani, first of all. That's me. And with me is...
Steven! That's me.
Yeah.
Your co-host of the Rebel Order.
Hello.
And we are humming along with our Millennium Falcon ambient noise. Isn't that nice?
Oh, I see.
It's just like we're on the ship right now.
It's beautiful. It's so relaxing. It's a very relaxing sound, that like ambient to space noise, yeah. That like humming. We're so excited to be back this week. We took a little hiatus off because our lives have sort of been in...
It rained in Miami.
Yeah.
And I had to spend, like 8 days in a hospital while my Darth Vader was in a Bacta tank for a little bit.
So, otherwise known as, he had a family member in the hospital.
My dad was in the hospital.
Your dad was in the hospital, yeah. Well, you know,
let's translate that.
And, I don't know, did you? That was very confusing. And, so we've kind of been dealing with that, obviously. Family comes first, always. Yeah. So, we're glad to be back, and we're very excited about this week's topic of discussion, which is going to be the beautiful, the illustrious, the battered, worn, but not broken, the beautiful, gotten it where it counts, Millennium Falcon. Gotten it. That's right. That's a wonderful chewy noise. Are you gonna keep that in there? You're keeping that?
My own chewy voice?
Yeah, I love
of
it.
Of course, yeah.
Do it. We're gonna talk all about the Falcon this week, and our Hollywood Holocron of the week is going to be all about centered around the Falcon and its design. But before we do that, I think we can get started with some news. Unless you have anything other personal you wanna add this week. Anything else?
We're also recording just in case there's any crowd noise with the Midnight Hounds.
As always.
At Midnight Hounds on Instagrams, our dogs, Xena, Duke, Morty, and Rusty. We have used some of our Force abilities to tame them to the best of our ability. But, you know, we never know when they want to have a commercial break.
They're always, they're riled up. They're like easily rileable dogs. But,
So let's do some news! Yeah.
Yeah. I'm sorry. I was just looking at your facial expression.
News.
Yeah.
So, this week, thanks to some executives and managers talking, we learned a small tidbit about the announced Star Wars series that David Benioff and Weiss are working on.
Famous for Game of Thrones.
For Game of Thrones, which now everyone is eagerly anticipating its release in April.
Oh, the season finale.
But
yeah.
Their agents said that they were working on a Game of and on a Star Wars trilogy. So that sounds like it's not a TV show. It is clearly three movies. That is what trilogy means.
And as you can see, we are all very thirsty, hungry for any news. when we're like, yeah, an agent's telling us something fun and interesting.
Agent said things. Did you hear that?
So if you've been around in the Star Wars fandom for the past 2 weeks, you've noticed that things have gotten pretty thirsty and desperate around here. Last week, there was a quarterly earnings call with the Disney leadership, Bob Iger and others, reciting facts and figures, and a whole heap of us, myself included, I will shamefully admit this, we're all listening in with bated breath, hoping that we were going to get some news about Episode 9. Of course,
all you heard was that TLJ was a great success.
Exactly. That was the one amazing thing we did here, Star Wars related. The Last Jedi was an amazing and wonderful success. They said that it drove up sales of merchandise, so that was kind of a fun thing to hear, because obviously, as you know, the prevailing antagonistic theory on the internet is that The Last Jedi was a terrible failure. You know, next time they want someone to fail $1.3 billion worth of stuff, please, fail me $1.3 billion.
I know, Rusty. Another $1.3 billion.
Exactly. but, you know, so The Last Jedi was a wonderful success, but other than that, we did not learn Bupkis. So, a few short days after that, we got our first major leak, and the prevailing conspiracy theory is that they dropped it on us because we were so desperate that they did not want
what
us
mean
to
they
die.
Drop it
like
on
Like
us.
The Disney Corporation.
So Disney purposefully leaked.
Yeah, the conspiracy is that they conspiratorially, like, they need something and they're all going to die of dehydration, and so they just kind of put it out there. Mm-hmm. But we're not going to talk about it in depth here, but just we will post a link. It's basically a major leak of concept art and costume lighting shot, beauty shot imagery. So, you know, for the costumes, they do photo shoots where it's nothing glamorous. It's just them sort of standing with the costumes with different lighting cues in order to kind of sort of get a concept of if the costumes are working for what they want or not. They have some of those. And then they also have some artwork. You see all of our big sequel heroes in it, and you also see some new fun aliens. We are not going to talk about it, like I said, in depth, but I will post the link.
Because it may or may not be spoilery.
Exactly. And we do, obviously, do talk about spoilers here, but we usually like to give you a very big grand warning.
Yeah, or we would put it at the end of the show.
Exactly.
You.
We don't like to put it at the beginning. And then our last piece of news is that there were a ton of new Star Wars Celebration guests announced. I will not go through
and
all of them.
And we will be at Star Wars Celebration.
Yes.
Because we have Jedi Master VIP passes, so we'll be at all the panels, doing all the dope stuff. We will be everywhere.
Everywhere. The big guest that sort of popped up, aside from all the wonderful other guests that are coming up, was the Emperor Palpatine himself, Ian McDiarmid, who will be there to force lightning the life out of you, shock you into oblivion. Very exciting. They also started to put up the pricing for autographs and photo ops. So if you are a person who is really into getting your signatures and getting your pictures taken with your favorite voice actors, authors, then take a look at the Star Wars Celebration website, because it is coming to you. We're getting closer and closer, folks. It's very exciting. This is going to be a pretty amazing Star Wars Celebration, just simply because it's the first one I'll ever be going to. So obviously it will be amazing, because I'll be there. And
yeah.
Steven will be there too, you know, but me.
And we will be dressed to kill, because Dani just hooked us up for Valentine's Day with some awesome Pozu Star Wars shoes
that we
look forward to rocking.
Yes,
at
please,
Star Wars Celebration.
We have been telling you to tell them how much money is spent on shoes. I know.
Is that a trade secret?
No, it's not. should it be? I've become very addicted to Star Wars sneakers in the past few months, especially since they just keep releasing new ones. Like, every time I turn around, there's some new Star Wars sneakers.
Just force choke me when I say too much.
Yeah. And so I think that's it. I don't have any other news. You have any other news, Steven?
I think that's all that we have for this week,
that's
as we just wait for drops of sweet news from the cactus that is Star Wars.
We are still waiting for a title. We are still waiting for a teaser. We are still
It's becoming ever more evident each day we wait
that this
that
is going to happen at Star Wars Celebration.
We are going to be
yeah.
in the room at Star Wars Celebration when
yeah.
we have to conceive of,
yeah.
wrap our minds around this title.
Yeah.
And
the
visuals
trailer.
Of the trailer.
That's kind of why I want them to drop the trailer first, though. We need a second to process the name of the movie before you see the trailer. Like, to name them both at the same time. Because what if the name is something kind of, like, weird and goofy, and we're like, ugh?
Yeah, but I think that it'll give them the, hypothetically, like, control of, like, you're controlling the narrative of your,
But they already control
the narrative,
man.
No, I'm saying you're controlling the narrative, because, well, the problem with the Star Wars fan base is that people like to run amok with the narrative
theories, yeah.
of the franchise. So
yeah.
if you put the title right next to the trailer, you are giving your, what's it called? Your marketing, you know, the proper, correct, you know, message, hopefully. It's not just a title, and then people are like, The Last Jedi? Who's The Last Jedi? Is it Rey? Is it Luke? Is it her?
But I'm sorry,
is it
but
it?
Part of,
is it her?
Part of what
And then the
makes,
trailer's like, there is no Last Jedi.
But part of what makes the Star Wars fandom is the insane speculation, you know?
I know.
For better or for worse, it's part and parcel of our sort of community. So I still feel like they might drop the title before the teaser. I'm definitely of the belief that we will not see a single filmed image until we walk into that Star Wars Celebration room. But the title, maybe in March, before Celebration, maybe.
I just think that it's
maybe.
To save us from...
I heard Dominic Monaghan said that only J.J. Abrams knows the title at this point. So that he's the only one. He was asked that question on Instagram, and then he was told. And he told everyone, only J.J. knows.
Yeah, that's a lie. Kathleen Kennedy knows for sure.
J.J.'s keeping his own mystery box.
And enough about J.J.'s mystery box. Let's talk about our Hollywood Holocron for this week.
The Holocron, if you please.
Tell me.
And our Hollywood Holocron is the man, the myth, the legend, Joe Johnston. Someone who's been with Lucasfilm since A New Hope. Joe answered an ad seeking a storyboard artist and was surprised to find out that he was going to work for George Lucas, who at the time had only made American Graffiti and THX 1138.
So this was his first job, or this was, no, this was just...
This was his first, like, yo, I want to do something.
Wow.
Let me take my greater steps into a new world.
That's amazing.
And his art skill got him through the door at Lucasfilm. He's a very gifted artist. So he started working on early storyboards, and when they were entering production and decided to redo the design of the Falcon because it was too similar to Space 1999, which was a British television show that was popular at the time. I'll have Joe Johnston say it here in this clip.
You know, we had the ship that was the Millennium Falcon completely built.
Right.
That became the Rebel Blockade Runner.
Right.
But when Space 1999 came out, George saw that ship, the Eagle.
Right.
He said, it's too close to Han Solo's ship. We need a new design for Han Solo's ship. It should be as far from that sort of long-pointed ship.
Right.
You know? And he basically said it can be anything. Just make it as different as possible. He says, I don't even care if it looks like a flying saucer.
Oh, really? And that was it?
I didn't want it to look like a flying saucer, so I added all these... It was a saucer shape.
Right.
But it had all these other things coming off of it that broke the, you know, the saucer shape.
So then it was drawn up by the draftsman exactly to that model,
because
they said, this is what's going to be shot, so you've got to duplicate that full size. That got built, and then...
Joe Johnston worked with Lucasfilm, but around the time of Empire Strikes Back, after designing Boba Fett during Empire Strikes Back, which he basically reworked a Ralph McQuarrie design of a white stormtrooper into the now coloration and pattern and design of Boba Fett that we know and love. He also added the sweet jetpack, which you'll find out comes back later in his career. And the character that Boba Fett was designed on was originally labeled the Super Trooper by Ralph McQuarrie. So that obviously added a little bit into his design. Joe Johnston has been involved in some of... Well, in 1984, after Empire Strikes Back, he wanted to leave Lucasfilm. He didn't know what he wanted to do, but he just wanted to travel. And George was like, you're too talented, and I've invested so much time in teaching you. I'll tell you what. Stay on working at Lucasfilm for half your salary. And
thanks, George.
I will pay for your tuition in USC Film School. I'll pay your whole way through USC Film School, and let's get you properly educated to be a filmmaker and a director. And Joe Johnston didn't have to think about it too long and said, yes, I will take that offer. So Joe Johnston, it turns out that was a good decision, and he went on to direct Honey, I Shrunk the Kids, The Rocketeer, which you see also has a jetpack, The Pagemaster, Jumanji, October Sky, Jurassic Park 3, Hidalgo, The Wolfman, the Benicio del Toro one, and Captain America, The First Avenger. He was in, he's a part of the Marvel fabric. He also directed a film called Not Safe for Work, and recently, as of 2018, The Nutcracker and the Four Rural Realms. Four Realms.
I'm glad that Disney was still using him, but it, yeah, it's kind of unfortunate because I know Nutcracker didn't do as well, but he's made some classic films, and I know, for instance, The Rocketeer is a huge cult movie. Awesome. If you've never heard of it, it's a beautiful film. You should check it out. It's one of his best.
Also, to add to his nerd resume, as if it isn't deep enough already,
he designed the
Millennium Falcon, The Rocketeer, he helped design Yoda and Boba Fett. He also designed the Iron Giant.
Whoa.
Yes.
Wow.
The Iron Giant.
The Iron Giant is another classic, to the point where he became even more of a classic when they just recently put him in Ready Player One.
Yep. Because he's so iconic. Even
he's so
after
iconic.
Just one movie.
Yeah.
It's how strong storytelling is.
Yeah.
Joe Johnston is still a part of the fabric of Star Wars as of 2011, mm-hmm. before it was... Lucasfilm was sold. He was campaigning with George that he wanted to direct a Boba Fett solo movie. And his one thing he said about the Boba Fett solo movie was that he felt that if you're going to do a Boba Fett movie right, that you absolutely never see Boba Fett's face. That would have been his mandate on Boba Fett. That he keeps his mystery through the
obviously,
whole
the Boba Fett
film.
Movie has been changed and mutated into the Mandalorian show, because as far as we know,
I don't think I wouldn't take those two
off at the same.
I wouldn't assume. I think the Mandalorian was already being produced when that story leaked about them working on Boba Fett after Solo was dropping that weekend. Also, one last thing about Joe Johnston. He said that the greatest film school he ever had was that he and George and Marshall Lucas worked on editing the end of Star Wars together.
Mm-hmm. And A New Hope.
And that what George would do would be, since editing wasn't as simple as working on a computer,
mm-hmm.
to get his editing done quicker and more clearly, he would have his storyboard artist draw the storyboards of the edits he wanted, and sometimes he'd have to add shots because they need more effect shots. So he worked with them storyboarding the film while they were in post-production. So in effect, he was doing like the early form of like animatics with
mm-hmm,
them,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
but just they had to do it on paper. They had to do it in an analog way.
Wow, that's really cool.
So it's kind of interesting to see how also George was developing all these filmmaking processes so early on in Star Wars that would then become, the touchstones for Lucasfilm.
Absolutely. So, you know, obviously, as you said, you know, he's had a very wonderful, illustrious career, but one of the most historically relevant things he ever did was help make the Millennium Falcon what it is today.
For sure.
And obviously, tons of people were involved with that. I actually found, doing research for this episode, I found this amazing website called kitbashed.com that did an extensive and painstakingly detailed history of the conceptual design of the Millennium Falcon. We'll put a link up. And we can segue right into what our episode is going to be about this week, our meet, which is all about the Millennium Falcon.
Yeah!
Woo!
The ship that the galaxy...
The ship known around the world.
Yep.
Globally, the Millennium Falcon is
the
a symbol
of Star Wars. The one that smuggled its way into
Star
your heart.
Wars. Yes. When you think of Star Wars, you think Skywalkers, you think Han Solo, and you think the Millennium Falcon and Princess Leia.
Well, in general, when you think of spaceships
think
in
of
science
Falcon.
Fiction,
you think of
there's two spaceships.
Yeah.
The Enterprise and the Millennium Falcon.
Exactly. And, I mean, interestingly enough, because Star Wars is not really science fiction, it's science fantasy. But like you said, exactly. It's the Falcon and the Enterprise, the two biggest ships in the world.
Interplace, sorry, a Star Destroyer.
So our goal with this discussion is not to get too techie, because as I said, this has been done far better and far more painstakingly detailed by other people. I will put
yeah.
a few links up.
This article though is really fantastic.
Yes, the Kitbashed article is fantastic.
It has. Anything you've ever wanted to know.
About the concept
about the
design.
Detail
yeah.
of how it evolved.
Exactly.
Is all there.
It's beautiful.
Let's, before we get into, because we're going to eventually get into how the Millennium Falcon, what it means to the
yeah,
story
we
of the Star Wars saga.
We wanted to explore it from a more narrative standpoint, but obviously we should talk a little bit about the...
Just in general.
The meat and potatoes.
The Millennium Falcon is a super cool spaceship.
Yes.
Okay, super cool dynamite spaceship.
Dynamite.
It is beloved. I don't know of anyone who doesn't like the Millennium
Falcon.
Falcon.
Yeah,
I've never how there's like you know that unpopular opinion sometimes where someone's like, well, unpopular opinion.
Yeah.
I don't like.
I've never
blankety
seen,
blank.
I've never
heard anyone
seen
say
that unpopular opinion. Yeah.
Anyone be like, oh, Millennium Falcon?
Yeah, I've never
no.
seen it. I really haven't.
It's really like,
if you hate the Millennium Falcon, then you can tweet us and let us know. But I don't know. But you might get attacked. So just tweet with caution. I guess
we had a Star Wars wedding, and one of the highlights of the Star Wars wedding for me was building our Lego Millennium Falcon to be able to use as a prop
mm-hmm.
at our wedding.
Yeah.
Which now they even have a I think Lego has produced at least like six versions.
And now they have
of
a
the Millennium
huge
Falcon,
version
and now their
now.
Current version is like almost like 5,000 pieces.
Yeah.
And is twice as big
yeah.
as any Falcon has ever been.
They
before.
started. Lego started to do like iterations of their stuff where it was like X like 3 feet long. So so far they've done like a 3 foot long Millennium Falcon, and they did a 3 foot long Imperial Star Destroyer. But yeah, they've had many different versions. They've had the OT version. They've had the sequel trilogy version. I think they made a Solo version. I'm not sure.
Yeah, there's
a solo version.
Of course
yeah. There's so many different versions of the Millennium Falcon. It is such, you're right, it is such a beloved spaceship. It is a representative. It is the symbol, besides lightsabers, it is the most visually, like, recognizable
this
symbol.
Is Star Wars.
This is Star Wars. The
Stamp
Millennium Falcon.
Them.
Yeah, exactly.
Millennium Falcon has also crossed over into other films. ILM, who did a lot of the special effects for the Star Trek
mm-hmm.
film franchise, smuggled a Millennium Falcon
so what?
Into
like
Star Trek First
in.
Contact.
Oh my goodness.
When there's a giant wolf 354 space battle in front of Earth or whatever.
So, I mean, according to, like...
Fighting the Borg. Millennium Falcon was fighting the Borg with them.
So, according to, like, nerddom, that would mean that we've already found a way to incorporate the Star Trek and Star Wars universe together into one piece.
For one shot, yes.
Mm-hmm.
Supposedly.
You think,
Han
Solo would listen to the Federation?
No,
no way.
My headcanon is that it makes sense Star Trek-wise, and that in the world of... No, in the world of Star Trek,
yeah.
there is Star Wars, and people love Star Wars.
Oh.
And some... Uber Star
Ooh.
Wars fan in the 24th century
yeah.
built a perfect battle ready Millennium Falcon, and when he saw the Borg were coming for Earth,
he's like
that's a big square, this thing's blown up a sphere before I can take it out.
that's actually a very good idea, and I bet you I like that headcanon you have
there. Write that fanfic.
Yeah, I like it.
Another notable auxiliary mention of the Falcon was that the Millennium Falcon in Lego form, as we were saying,
mm-hmm.
was put in the Lego movie. It's
yes.
one of the biggest highlights of the Lego movie.
Yes.
Is seeing it fly in
but
with Lando.
Some of the biggest highlights of the Lego movie are just watching all your favorite characters come together in Lego form.
Of course.
Yeah.
But I'm
but
saying
yeah.
that especially.
I know what you're saying.
It's like burned into my brain.
Totally.
Another cool reference, because the Millennium Falcon got used up, or not used up, is that my word? That's very
used
negative.
Up.
I'm saying Millennium Falcon got its due during the EU days, now Legends,
mm-hmm.
When, spoilers for many years ago.
For the EU.
When Chewbacca died,
mm-hmm.
Han Solo, grieving,
mm-hmm.
painted the Millennium Falcon all black in the comics and flew around in an all-mourning
That's what Kylo's
version
gonna do when he gets the
Falcon.
He's gonna be like, Dad, I always wanted to paint in black.
This needs paint and a stripe.
So, okay, thank you for all the auxiliary references, because, yes, the EU is auxiliary, because it is no longer canon. Cry more, fanboys, about it.
I have one last EU.
Oh, I'm sorry. Ooh, wait, one more.
Sorry.
One more auxiliary
and
fact.
And it plays into a Star Wars legend.
Uh-huh.
So this is from the book from Star Wars Legends, Millennium Falcon, by James Luceno. This is an origin for the name of the Millennium Falcon.
Wait, this is the EU, right? So this is not canon.
This is Star Wars Legends, so it's Legends.
Okay.
Which is now what they branded the EU.
Okay.
So this is what they said then, okay?
Mm-hmm.
This is a scene where a guy named Fargo, who once owned the Millennium Falcon, when he owned it, he called it Gone to Pieces. Leia is asking Han what he named the Falcon,
mm-hmm.
since it's obviously not named the Gone to Pieces. He says,
I like that, the Gone to Pieces.
I renamed her fast as a bat falcon, resilient enough to last a millennium. And that is how we call the Millennium Falcon.
I like that. But,
which also is very similar, if you remember when Solo, right before it was about to come out,
mm-hmm.
there was like this big spoiler leak, supposedly, that Chewbacca was going to name the Millennium Falcon, and it was going to be named after a mythical a Kashyyyk firebird that comes every 2,000 years.
But in the end, they just decided
no,
just
no,
to keep
that,
it.
That it's like a Wookiee word.
Oh, yeah.
And then it translates into Millennium Falcon.
Yeah, but, I mean, obviously, as we know,
they
never really gave the...
No,
Lando
named it the Falcon.
He
gave
Millennium
it a dope
Falcon.
Name.
Yeah, exactly. That's all. He gave it a dope name. It's Lando. So, but it wasn't anything, like, fancy like that. It wasn't Han doing it. It was Lando doing it. So, yeah, those are good. I like those auxiliary facts. But...
Hey, baby. Hold again.
Falcon. So, this is just some quick tech specs. The Millennium Falcon, and I got all this from Wikipedia, guys, because Wikipedia is the best source ever, and I'll link to it. The Millennium Falcon, this original designation is the YT-1300-492727ZD. How exciting. And it's a Corellian YT-1300F light freighter. All right, so I think we all know that, but I'm just repeating it. The Millennium Falcon.
It's been on t-shirts.
It's been on t-shirts.
At Target.
Exactly. That's right. At Target,
I got
you
one.
Can get, you can even get a whole schematic of the Millennium Falcon. The interesting thing about, again, always about the fact, especially now with Solo, Star Wars Story having come out, that it is a Corellian ship, is that Han Solo is from Corellia, and that his father built ships on Corellia. So it kind of almost seems like the Millennium Falcon was destined to come to him, being a Corellian, and coming from a family of Corellian spaceship builders.
And that's a great wrinkle that Solo introduced,
yeah.
that the Falcon is... Han's closest connection to his idea of family and home.
Exactly.
Well,
that's why he recognized it. You know, like in a way, he felt a kinship with it immediately because he felt
his
that.
Father could have
yeah.
built it.
Exactly.
His father's hands could
You're
have
right.
been
his
on
father's hands
any
could
piece
have been
of
on that,
that
piece.
Ship.
Exactly.
Like that's all he has left.
This is a fun fact that I learned on Wikipedia. In the time following the Battle of Endor, the Imperial Turncoat, Ralcius Paldora, noted that 2.2 out of every 300 stormtroopers were aware of the Falcon's existence.
Whoa.
That's a big deal because, you guys know, there are a ton of stormtroopers. There are so many soldiers in the Imperial Army, and even now in the First Order Army, to know the Millennium Falcon like that. By like, it's just a, it's an extreme. Even in our universe, it's an extremely famous ship, and in the Star Wars galaxy, it's an extremely famous ship.
I think it's the
it's notorious.
It's the legend of this ship was inside the Death Star.
Yeah.
And got out unscathed.
Yep.
And then came back.
Yep.
To help strike the killing blow
yep.
on the Death Star, not once, but
twice. Yeah.
Oh my gosh.
It flew around.
Like, can you imagine the stormtrooper? Like, it must be like their ghost story.
Yeah, and especially since it looks so beat up and bruised that it's like, how could you know? Because in the Empire and in the First Order, they value technological advancement so much. They value shiny new toys. They value shiny new weapons. So for something that looks like it's about to break apart upon entry into hyperspace,
also,
to do all this damage to their team is sort of like very, kind of unbelievable to them.
Some of the in-universe, scope of the Falcon is that the YT, 1300?
Mm-hmm.
Sorry. Is like the one of the most common ships.
It's the Camry.
So it's the Toyota. It's the Toyota Camry.
It's
a Toyota Civic.
Galaxy. Yeah.
It's a Toyota Civic.
Oh yeah, and we learned
the Star
that
Wars
fact.
Universe.
We learned the fact that the reason why that is important is because a lot of smugglers use YT freighters in varying iterations
configurations
because it's such a popular ship. So it's great for sneaking around. Another fun fact. The original name for the Millennium Falcon, before they called it the Millennium Falcon for A New Hope, was just simply Pirate Ship.
Yeah.
Pirate Ship. So this is another, moving on to another fun fact that's going to lead into some discussion. Apart from the shape of its chassis, the Falcon retained very little of its off-the-dock instrumentation. Because its successive owners either upgraded or downgraded every system according to their personal specifications, the freighter ended up becoming a unique ship. So the Falcon, one of the reasons why it's so recognizable, and what's kind of interesting about that, is that Han likes to use it because it's the Toyota Camry, but it's kind of like the Toyota Camry with like that huge spoiler in the back, that like this flame sticker is coming down the side.
Yeah.
Like it's become so unique because of how many kind of different ways it's been battered and bruised and reshaped and molded into the different kind of like needs for each of the people
so,
who've owned it.
Some of the smaller changes we can see very readily on film is in
yeah.
the original trilogy, it has a round dish up top.
Yep.
And then during Return of the Jedi, Lando gets that dish knocked off.
Yep.
So when we were reintroduced to it in The Force Awakens, it now has been modified with a square dish.
Yeah.
Above it?
Internally and externally. Like, a lot of the external stuff obviously seems to be battle damage. Damage from flying around.
Mm-hmm.
In Solo, a Star Wars story, they did... You know, this is still sort of a controversial thing for me. I liked it, but I also kind of found it a little lazy that they were like, we're just going to make it look like how you know it and love it, like, as soon as possible by kind of when he flies into the Kessel Run and they just start getting pieces sucked off by the huge maw.
I thought that was...
You like that?
I loved it.
It's just kind of like, I kind of knew they were going to have to do something like that. I knew that they were going to go for a shortcut.
I thought that was the
like
funnest
that.
Way. I think it's the cartoon thing.
Yeah.
Of like, you want to see something like driving till the
yeah,
wheels fall
yeah.
off.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's funny to feel like this whole movie is the journey of
but it's,
the Falcon
it was,
getting into
will
the position.
Say, it's thing. Honestly a pretty, like... It, like the if you're looking for the quickest way to make the Falcon look like the Falcon that everybody knows, it was a genius way to do it because they had to launch the escape pod, a bunch of stuff stripped off the ship.
Yeah, they fought a black hole and a Cthulhu monster.
Then things
and Star Destroyers
things
and
caught on
yeah.
fire, so the beautiful like, you know, sexy interior that Lando had built into like Lando had built this ship as his pleasure palace, dude. Lando had built this ship as his leisure place. He took ladies in there. He like talked people up in there. He was like he had his cape closet, and then within like it being in the hands of Han Solo for like 40 minutes, it was just turned to a wreck.
But it's the beauty of the storytelling
yeah.
that in the moment that it becomes the legendary Falcon. It literally transforms into
Han's
it's
ship.
Like
yeah.
it's as if like it's always been waiting to be sculpted
by Han
into this perfect ship by the Force.
Yeah.
The perfect ship by the second most perfect
the
ship.
The second most perfect ship.
The Millennium Falcon.
Ah.
And then it's, you know, just going to lay there on the sand until Han puts it back together enough to fly around and make back what he owes.
One of the most interesting sort of unique additions to the ship, and a sort of controversial one, is that, okay, so if I learned this reading the wonderful Last Jedi novelization by Jason Fry. If you have not read it, you should read it. It's a great addition to learning kind of about the ins and outs of the Last Jedi. It has its own unique voice. It only adds to your understanding of the film. If you enjoyed the Last Jedi, I think you'd really enjoy the book.
And it was co-written. No, Ryan Johnson advise?
Ryan Johnson was a creative consultant. Yes, he helped. Yeah, it wasn't co-written.
Sorry, I thought he had his hands deep in it.
He had his hands in it, but he didn't write it.
Sorry.
Don't make Jason Fry mad at me.
I added the periods. No, you didn't, Ryan.
Ryan Johnson. I'm sorry, Ryan Johnson. He consulted with Jason Fry, and he actually gave him some deleted scenes that were used in the book that were not put into the movie that they wanted to put, for instance, like Han Solo's funeral. Anyway, so the cool thing that Jason wrote in his story was that the Millennium Falcon actually has three droid brains that operate the ship. And what's cool about that is that we learn that one of those droid brains is L337, who operates as the navigational computer for the Millennium Falcon.
Well, those three droid brains have been in canon since the 80s.
Okay.
And
I didn't know that until I read The Last Jedi. I'm sorry. I didn't read books in the 80s. I was 4.
No, I'm saying that's what was so exciting is that they kept that spec detail.
In
the book.
Oh, that was, you found this in your research.
Yeah.
Okay.
Which is why Ryan used it.
See the, yeah,
and
exactly.
Told them to, what's up?
Yeah.
And Solo. From the one.
But I wanted to, yeah, so, and you know, obviously the naming of one of the droid brains as L3 has been sort of a controversial decision. I love that L3 is a part of the Millennium Falcon, but yes, it is sort of, because, you know, if you know L3 as a character,
who'd think someone trying to be revolutionary would be controversial?
She valued her individual freedoms quite a bit, and to sort of be loaded into the Falcon is kind of taking away her choice of whether or not she wants to sort of exist on as a... However, the positive thing I'll say is, knowing L3's in the ship, I wonder if they thought they were kind of naming the sort of rebellious spirit that exists inside the Falcon that sort of inspires
people to
use it as a symbol of freedom.
I like to see the light side, and
yeah.
I like to see that, like, L3, despite having this, you know, this, you know, quick, untimely death, she got to live on and save people and do good and take out the Death Star and,
At the same time, it is also just giving.
And it also reimagines every scene that you've seen now in Star Wars. Anytime the Millennium Falcon acts up and it leads to Han and Leia kissing, is L3 watching from inside the Falcon, like, cheering on?
I don't want to make it that
L3's... like, I navigated that!
I don't want to make it that L3's only concern as in her existence
yes,
as a ship
hook people up.
Was to hook people up, but I will read this great excerpt from...
That's what navigational computers do.
Yeah,
they hook things
up. Of
course,
they navigate your love life. Happy Valentine's Day. but I do want to read this great excerpt from the Last Jedi novelization that talks about R2 interacting with the Falcon and its all of its droid brains. This is the sequence where they're trying to find the last remaining rebels on Crait. Rey, R2-D2, and Chewie are frantically flying over Crait looking for them. They can't find them. And this is the excerpt. "The beacon's right beneath us," Rey said. "They've got to be somewhere. Keep scanning for life forms." The droid, R2-D2, in parentheses, so you know who it is, beeped an acknowledgement and urged the freighter to switch its sensors over to focus mode, probing the rock beneath them for matches with human energy signatures. The Falcon responded sulkily, then launched into a diatribe about its inadequate sensor rectennae, power feeds to the dish that remained misaligned more than 3 decades after the incident that had knocked them out of place, and Chewbacca's obviously deliberate refusal to prioritize repairs the way the freighter thought made sense. When the Falcon mentioned something about barely being able to detect the back end of a Bantha at high noon, R2-D2 suppress an electronic sigh. The Falcon had always been cantankerous, its three droid brains quarreling endlessly unless forced to work together. Still, R2-D2 usually got along with the ship well enough. For one thing, none of the brains could stand C-3PO. For another, one of them had a fondness for both romantic gossip and dirty jokes, both of which R2-D2 had learned to provide in large quantities.
Whoa.
So, I love this, because my biggest love has always been droids and the droid intelligence on Star Wars, because it is kind of one of the things that is the most murky in this droid, in the kind of Star Wars world. Like, the droids have sentience, do they believe in their rights? And then they made it even murkier by including L3, who obviously did believe in the idea of droids' rights. And it's kind of like, does no one see they're oppressing the robots, and nobody cares about that they're oppressing the robots, you know what I mean? But I still, every time I get a hint of the wonderful personalities that are in the droids, and that are in the ships, because all the ships have droid brains, even the X-Wings, everything has sort of a computer brain. And so I loved hearing that. And so I love knowing that that's kind of part. The Falcon is a living being in its own way.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? It's made of ship parts, but it has personality. It has three distinct personalities that sort of come together and work with and sometimes argue with the people that it's flying for. But I love that. I love the idea that the Falcon can sort of decide. So maybe there are times when it malfunctions, it's throwing a temper tantrum. Or maybe if someone bad came in and tried to use it, they wouldn't be able to use it because maybe the Falcon would be like, I don't want to work for you. Maybe that's the reason why Ankara Plot, when he stole it,
it wouldn't fly for
all those years, because it was waiting for someone that it recognized and appreciated
worthy.
That was worthy to come and fly it.
Yeah, almost like an Excalibur.
Exactly.
You know, lying in the lake.
There you
just
go.
Waiting for
exactly.
Ray to pick it up.
Totally.
Well, there's also the, it also reiterates, like, later in the series, and we see it now with Resistance,
mm-hmm.
That every droid, every piece of technology, no matter how old, whatever you find that you can reuse and recycle,
mm-hmm.
you need to recycle, because there's just not enough of stuff.
Yeah.
People can't just buy things.
Yeah, stuff is expensive,
so
you know.
You see on Jakku,
yeah.
everyone salvaging things.
Mm-hmm.
On the Colossus, everyone's salvaging and trying to use what they find and figure out how to make it work to get their components to fly properly.
And obviously, you know, when... Yeah, because parts are expensive,
mm-hmm.
and you know, it takes time to build things. And I really like that very real-world idea that they bring that in there. That's sort of like almost everyone in their own way is a little bit of a mechanic. Is a little bit of, like, they kind of have to start tinkering and learning how to tinker with their stuff.
It's also a kind of very modern sort of hipstery message that, like, the evil corporation gets all their stuff, like, brand new, shiny, clean.
Yeah.
And everyone else is shopping at the vintage hipster
store. and I wonder, too, if, like,
Why does this ship smell like a Wookiee? Ugh.
The Empire and the First Order, they create scarcity by trying to capitalize on all the parts, so they make it even harder for people to find things. So yeah, I mean, I love that too. And I think, you know, to talk about, before we talk about, I wanted to give you some fun nicknames that the Falcon has been given.
Whoa.
Before we talk kind of about how Han Solo and the Falcon are one with the Force, and the Force is with them. But these are some nicknames that have been given to the Falcon. Hunk of junk, garbage, and I put in parentheses, that will do. Because, you know, the garbage will do. Bucket of bolts. And those are the ones that I kind of thought at the top of my head I was looking for. And then I love this quote from Han Solo. She may not look like much, but she's got it where it counts, kid. I've made a lot of special modifications myself. And he said that in A New Hope. And I love that quote because I think that it illustrates how the Falcon and Han Solo become one, you know? Like we talked about before, the Solo Star Wars story, the most exciting part, or one of the most exciting parts of that film was watching the Falcon become Han's,
mm-hmm.
and belong to him. And then And then all the chess pieces that go with that, like having Chewie as his co-pilot and having the ship look the way that it does. But essentially, the ship has become Han Solo's soul.
And Han originally sees it as the ship that he's going to, you know, fly off with Kira.
Yeah.
And it becomes the ship that
he flies off
will with. Change his destiny.
Mm-hmm.
Around the time of The Last Jedi, I think it was Kevin Smith on Kevin Smith's podcast,
mm-hmm.
that they were saying that every time a group of characters gets into the Falcon
mm-hmm.
in the films, they're never the same afterwards.
No, yeah.
After those trips in the Falcon, like, the first time you get in it, you lose Obi-Wan. The next time you get, you're in it for a while, you lose Han. And then the next time after that is, like, the last time you guys were all together and you just lost Vader.
The Falcon,
like,
is quite literally a narrative device
yeah.
at this point in the Star Wars galaxy.
Every time Luke meets the Falcon,
yeah.
his whole world has changed.
Yep.
Each time.
Yeah.
For him.
Yeah.
And for the audience, too. Each time the Falcon comes on screen, it means something else.
Yeah, it does.
In A New Hope, it is something that we're afraid of, you know what I mean? But is also something that we learn is awesome.
Mm-hmm.
And then in Empire, it's something that we realize is human and is flawed and is not as perfect and as impenetrable, and, you know, all the cracks really start showing
mm-hmm.
on the Falcon. And then by Return of the Jedi, it's just, we know this ship, we don't have anything else. This ship has to lead this assault.
Yeah.
And we need every ship that
it becomes the symbol of the rebellion.
Mm-hmm.
You know? They use it becomes such a symbol of the rebellion that Lando gets to fly it in the major fight. You know what I mean? And if Han Solo doesn't even fly it. You know? So, like, it's kind of, at the beginning, it's sort of inextricable with Han Solo. But then we've had that time period where he's sort of become his own character outside of just having the Falcon,
because
he falls in love with Leia and he wants to, and he actually embraces the sort of rebellion general behavior, you know, the role that he takes on, so he can, like, he can give that up for a second.
And you can see now that, like, especially with Solo, A Star Wars Story, and
mm-hmm.
seeing literally how Han and Lando vied for the ship and felt about the ship, that Han, you know, Lando stepped up when Han couldn't.
Yeah.
And Lando took care of his little space family
mm-hmm.
and brought him back to the Falcon, and now Han trusts him
yeah.
totally with the Falcon to fly it into battle, into the most dangerous situation ever.
My favorite thing about how the Falcon, you know, and that's the thing too, is that the Falcon, one of the reasons why I did like the L3 thing, because it did kind of feel that no matter where the Falcon passed hands, a little piece of, like, Lando's life was in there too.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I really like that because, yeah, you can, I really like what they did in Solo, where Lando and Han, they have a rival kind of relationship, but it's born of, like, a respect. They sort of recognize each other, you know? Like, they sort of see each other. They both kind of bluster and talk big, you know, but they have good hearts, and they try to hide that from people. So then, moving into The Force Awakens, and the Falcon, you know, after, you know, we kind of now, you know, it's so interesting to get the backstory of the Falcon after we sort of restarted the trilogy, but I liked that they did that,
mm-hmm.
because it adds context to what we've seen in The Force Awakens and The Last Jedi. So, you know, in The Force Awakens, they have to get the Falcon back into Han's hands, and Han has lost it. And again, as we talk about how Han and the Falcon are one.
Well, it even more so,
mm-hmm.
Disney, vis-a-vis the trailer for The Force Awakens,
yeah.
connects, like, Han is back in the Falcon.
Yeah.
Han says,
we're
home.
Yeah.
In a way, it's like the fans, Disney telling the fans, the Falcon's here, you're home.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that is very important because it does. It's telling us, because like we've said, how the Falcon for Star Wars is the cultural phenomenon. It is the home.
George only put the Falcon in one shot of the spaceport in The Phantom Menace. George didn't feel like, or at least for the prequels, he didn't feel like it was right to put the Falcon.
And even then,
as
even,
a part of them.
Even putting it in the prequel is kind of like, is it canonically like, you know what I mean?
Is it our Falcon? Is it just another,
is it another random YT? But it is missing the escape pod. But at the time, did they even...
But no, Solo takes place
after
Phantom Menace.
Exactly, that's what I'm saying.
So, but it could have been stripped and repainted and four or five times before
added and
I never got it.
The escape pod added and then removed and then added and removed. Yeah, maybe.
Before I never got it.
Maybe.
That's even more ironic.
It's possible. But then, and I guess, could his dad have built that one? With his hands?
But components, you know? All the
that's
YTs
one of those
are
things,
slapped together, right?
That's one of those things. It's like, should we retcon that in The Phantom Menace? Like, should we just pull that out of there? But to talk about the idea of home, I love that they've tied the Falcon story in the sequel trilogy to Han's story and to Han's life and the mistakes that he's made and the triumphs that he's had. I think it's brilliant. I do. And I think that it creates a narrative thread. I mean, already we knew in the OT that the Falcon and Han Solo were linked as one.
Mm-hmm.
But it really felt, you know, he loved that ship, but it felt that way, but it wasn't narratively like the most important thing. It was just that the Falcon was a very important ship to Han Solo, and
we've never seen him away from it.
Exactly.
So we've never seen what it means to him to not have it.
Yeah.
And The Force Awakens introduces us to him in this
different place.
Weird ship that's not anywhere close to the Falcon.
It's a huge frigate.
And when Han steps in the Falcon again, we see physically what it means to him.
Mm-hmm.
It shakes him.
Yeah.
And Chewie too.
And I think, I guess they, when they were looking at the OT, they were looking at that idea that like, wow, Han is always with the Falcon. And when he does lose it, quote unquote, he never really actually loses it. It just changes. It goes back into Chewie's hands because he's...
No, it got stolen.
He's in carbonite.
But after somewhere in between the Battle of Endor
I'm not talking about that period
it was
we don't
stolen
see.
By somebody who stole it from
but
him.
But I'm not talking about that period
okay.
that we don't see. I'm talking about in the original trilogy,
mm-hmm.
New Hope, Empire, Return
yeah.
of the Jedi. It's always with him. The only time he doesn't have it, he's literally frozen in carbonite, so he doesn't even feel the loss. Because he has no idea that, like, yesterday feels like today, you know what I mean? Like, a year ago feels like 2 hours ago.
Yeah. Chewbacca's like, I kept up the insurance, it's okay.
So I really enjoy that when making the choices for the sequel trilogy, they were like, we are going to make this ship even more inextricable from the idea of Han Solo, and we're going to take it away from him. And by taking it away from him, it's taking away a piece of who Han Solo is. And for him to step back on the ship is for him to embrace what he had become at the end of the OT, which was the hero, a leader.
A rebel,
exactly.
And we see a father. He's ready to take on his paternal duties. Like, what does it mean that Han didn't really, you know, he didn't feel like he was ready to see his son until he had his ship again?
Is a very interesting thing, because when you read the auxiliary, like the outside the film books and stories, like, for instance, The Last Shot by Joseph...
Last Shot, the latest Star Wars novel. You don't need to give all the information.
I don't?
No, you could just say in the Star Wars novel Last Shot.
Right. Okay.
Boom.
So yeah, in the novel, the most recent novel about Han Solo, Last Shot, that they released right before Solo, and then even in Bloodline, the novel that they did before
that's centered around Leia.
The Force Awakens is centered around Leia. Han is constantly running away with the Falcon. He's constantly doing other things and having duties, and so he kind of uses he starts to use the Falcon as an escape again. And unfortunately, that escape takes him away from his family, mm-hmm. takes him away from his son. And so to in The Force Awakens, to come back to it and then to use it to get to his son, is very significant narratively and emotionally for him. And it's important because the other thing we can't help but talk about, because it is inextricable from Han Solo, and also Han Solo is inextricable from Ben Solo, his father. Ben Solo sees that ship as it's very significant to him, whether positive or negative, you know, because
that ship is a symbol of his father.
Exactly.
And as we see at the end of The Last Jedi, when he wants it blasted out of the sky, and that's, you know, he loses sight of his...
He's angry, yeah. It's
of
rich.
His goals.
Yeah.
Because of how triumphant and
badass... How triggering that ship... No, yeah, of course. Yes, that's exactly what... No, but yeah, just because of how emotionally triggering that ship is to him. And it's because there is a sense of loss when he looks at it. Obviously more because he killed his father, but also too because it represents the things that he lost before Han had died, even before Han had been killed by him, in that when he was young, and this is in the Last Jedi novelization, and also you can find this information in the Star Wars databank. They've really kind of been driving it home. Ben Solo wanted to be a pilot like his father.
Whoa.
Like, that was his big desire. I want to be a pilot like my daddy.
Whoa.
He would play with the dice all the time and talk about that as a baby. This was a very important thing. So it represents a lot to Ben Solo and Han Solo, and that this represented the thing that that Ben wanted to be for his father, but then his father kept flying away in it, so it started to turn and turn
negative.
Like, he's leaving me every time and I don't like it. And then even worse, when he turns and his family betrays him, or he feels all of his family has betrayed him, and then it's now, and then when he kills his own father, it's even more of this symbol of, look at all the ways that I've failed and my family has failed. Like, every time it's flying around him, it's very emotional for him. And I think that the Millennium Falcon, I really, I wondered when we kind of started to get the sequel trilogy going, how they were going to incorporate the Falcon into the movies. I really did. We wondered how you were going to do all of the original trilogy characters, but especially something like the Falcon. I was like, is the Falcon even running at this point? Like, it's been a long time, guys. Yeah. Like, that ship is, but obviously in the Star Wars galaxy, if you do even a modicum of upkeep to a ship, it can last forever. I guess it must be the hyperdrives and the...
Well,
you know what I mean?
You don't want to make something that's just going to be thrown away. You want it to at least last a millennium or two.
In the Star Wars universe, a toaster lasts forever. All right? They're not playing around.
Yeah.
They don't believe in this idea of planned obsolescence.
My toast tastes like the Phantom Menace.
They don't believe in planned obsolescence in the Star Wars universe. They believe that things gotta last forever. So, but I wondered how they were gonna do it, and I really love what they've done, because now they've truly turned the Falcon into this wonderful symbol of freedom.
I'd also like to note that on The Force Awakens deleted scenes,
mm-hmm.
We get a peek of Kylo Ren walking into the Falcon.
And that was cut.
And surveying the ship.
Mm-hmm.
And that all was cut.
And I think very strategically.
Strategically, yes.
Mm-hmm.
But in that film, we were going to get Kylo Ren destroying Imperial things with his lightsaber so angrily.
So
callously. But yet walking delicately.
Into the Falcon,
through
yeah.
his father's
yeah,
ship.
Yeah, he walks into the Falcon.
You know?
He's,
he could have chopped
yeah.
that ship apart.
He could have had a rage attack.
Ruined
yeah.
it, but
mm-hmm.
he didn't.
No.
But it was all deleted. But...
Yeah.
It was still the story they were trying to
but,
tell then.
Yeah.
And also, it's very, very interesting now knowing what we know about Kylo Ren, i.e. that he's Ben Solo.
Yeah.
That the first poster art we got was of him as Kylo Ren stepping out of the Falcon, holding Rey in his arms.
True.
If that one visual
yeah.
is a symbol of the entire franchise.
Of the trilogy. Yeah.
It is literally... the son of Solo coming out of Solo's soul to hold, hypothetically, somebody that was created in the Force, hypothetically, just for him. Like,
Yeah.
In a way.
In a way.
Yeah.
It created as a balance to him.
Mm-hmm.
Because, yeah, it's at this point, I believe it's pretty, it's not, obviously it hasn't been, you have to be careful because, you know, people get all itchy about this, but, like, hasn't been declared
mm-hmm.
as, like, someone didn't write it down on a piece of paper, but
mm-hmm.
Snoke says it, darkness rises and light to meet it.
Yeah.
Rey is 10 years older than, I mean, 10 years younger than Ben Solo. One could arguably imagine that by the time, and we've kind of gotten hints.
And it also makes sense with the prequel mythology, too, that Shmi had this immaculate conception, and this kid was getting the dark side when there was so much light side in the world.
Mm-hmm. True. You're right. But yeah, to continue, we can argue through kind of the inferences we've gotten about when Ben went to train with Luke. He was very young. So one could argue that the darkness started rising in him around that age, 10, 11, and that was the time that Rey was born. So the Force already knew darkness was rising in this kid.
Mm-hmm.
He needs balance. They need, we need balance. The Force needs balance. I must provide the balance. And the light is born. And I believe that theory. I know it hasn't been totally confirmed, but I think that there's too many hints of it
mm-hmm.
to not feel like it is significant.
And I feel like that darkness rising in him lies into, or would follow the same timeline as him becoming disillusioned with the Falcon and his father
mm-hmm.
and the hope that the Falcon inspires.
And then to go back to the Falcon, I think it's also the reason why Rey falls in love with the Falcon the way that she does. And she, you know, obviously when she first sees it, she says it's garbage. But then she gets behind the cockpit and she's in love.
She feels how
she
good
feels
it is.
How wonderful it is to fly it. Because the Falcon is one of, and a quick tech spec, the Falcon's like one of the fastest ships in the galaxy because of all the sort of modifications that have been put into it, the hyperdrive and everything like that. So for her to, and this is the first time Rey ever sees off-world is through the eyes, with the eyes of the Falcon. You know, through the windows of the Falcon. Then she meets Han Solo, who she affectionately calls the smuggler. You know, Finn's like the Rebellion General, she's like the smuggler, so she kind of knows that part of Han Solo. And I think what's kind of funny is, even though Han is all those things, he's a general, you know, he's a hero, but he, first and foremost, I think he truly values his identity as a smuggler. Because that's what he goes back to.
No, and that's the identity he
yeah.
made for himself.
For himself.
Like,
yeah.
on purpose.
Exactly.
You know what I mean?
So for her, for Rey to know the smuggler, for her to know that part of him, I think that's one of the reasons why he feels like an immediate kinship with her. You know? Like, he sort of bristles, but then he really is kind of like, he likes both Finn and Rey, but he especially, he offers her a place on the Falcon, like, and I think that's just because he sees so much of himself in her, and then he also sees, and he even says, Chewie likes you, you know, you do good on the Falcon, and I wonder if almost he would want to say the Falcon likes you, because it did, because it
yeah.
flew for her,
yeah.
you know?
And the other thing, too, is a lot of people read into the scene in The Force Awakens where Han is looking at Maz and, like, being, and, like, you know, talking about Rey.
Mm-hmm. Oh, when she asks,
sort of
the
giving
girl.
Off screen,
yeah.
you
mm-hmm.
know, what's going on with the girl. I like to imagine that, you know, Han and Maz having her connection to the Force and
mm-hmm.
Han having all the history with the Force,
mm-hmm.
that Han and her have had drunken discussions about how much this ship means to him. And can you believe that this, I ran into some other yokel from a desert planet,
mm-hmm.
and this yokel brought me my ship back.
Exactly.
Like,
yeah, like, I know a lot of people who...
This is so unlikely. Of course, this girl must deserve the ship.
A lot of people who believe in that race guy stuff still, to this day, won't die. They believe that was, like, a significant thing in regards to her parentage, but I don't think so. I think just Maz recognizes things in the Force. It doesn't mean that her parentage is special. It means that Rey is special. That's what kind of always annoys me about it, and that whole stupid thing that it's her parentage. No, it's not about who her parents were. It's about who Rey is. Rey is special. And she doesn't have to be special because her dad's Obi-Wan and her mom is Padme or whatever nonsense theory people think. You know what I mean? It's because she was born and she is the light in the Force. She is the powerful light to balance the dark. And Maz can recognize that. She says it. I see, you know, I know Jedi, but I know the Force.
Mm-hmm.
And so she asks Han that question because she can smell, she can sense the Force rolling mm-hmm. off of her. And then what happens after that? Rey goes down some stairs and touches the Legacy Saber. And it's so funny because it's like,
It's almost like Han and Maz, and Maz was like, hey, I'll bet you a beer that when she goes to the bathroom,
yeah,
she's going to come back a Jedi. Okay,
and, to,
sure.
And to cycle this back to the Falcon, it's, I think the Falcon kind of represents that idea too, that like, it is, you know, I think the Falcon and Han Solo are kind of linked, inextricably linked. I think it is the soul of Han in a way. It does, but obviously, the Falcon lives on after Han Solo dies. So the Falcon doesn't just belong to Han. Even though it carries his soul in it, his spirit. It's the spirit is what's important. It's that spirit of adventure. It's that spirit of freedom and individuality and fighting oppression. That, you know, like Han was a smuggler because he wanted to write his own story. You know, he didn't want to live under the foot of the Empire. He didn't want to, you know, even in his own way, even, yes, he didn't first be like, I'm going to be a hero and I'm going to save everyone. You know, he didn't take that first crumb when it was offered to him by Enfys Nest. You know, it doesn't matter. He was trying to live outside of the, even then he knew, like, living under the boot of the Empire is not good. You know, and maybe in his own way, he kind of thought, I'm doing my part by smuggling and stealing and messing them up. Because I'm living my way the way I want to, and the one thing the Empire wants to do is control people and control how they think, control how they live. And Han was like, no, I refuse to do that. And so the Falcon refuses to do that.
I'd also like to note for this podcast,
mm-hmm.
okay, because we've talked about Han Solo a lot, all right? Han is the, on paper, captain of the Millennium Falcon.
Yes.
I assume that's because if they get caught smuggling things, Chewbacca... has a record.
Because he's 100, he's 200 years old.
He was locked up a few times.
He was, yeah.
His people have been oppressed.
Yeah, yeah.
You don't want Chewbacca's name on the registry.
Yeah.
But Chewbacca's put just as much time.
You're right.
And now, after Han's death, more time than
you're
Han.
Right.
Into that ship. And he has been there flying that ship precision with Han. And now with Rey. And even though Han is gone, and the Falcon, I guess hypothetically, does it belong to Rey or does it belong to Chewie?
I think they've said that it belongs to Rey. Which, okay, and that's kind of what
is kind of messed up.
I wanted to bring it up because I haven't been talking about Chewie a lot, but that's because it really kind of feels like, okay, you think Chewie lost the Falcon? Han lost the Falcon. So it always kind of feels like Chewie.
But it was Chewie's home. Like,
yeah, but I'm
like,
saying. But that's what I'm saying.
Regardless of whether it's Han's
ship. I'm saying that all of the big major choices that have been made for the Falcon have been the cause of Han. So Han is that his destiny is linked to the Falcon. But I question like poor Chewie. Is Chewie just sort of like
okay in the cantina scene?
Yeah.
Han vouches for Obi-Wan, or
yes.
Chewie vouches for Obi-Wan.
Chewie does.
I think Chewie's the one who decides that Obi-Wan and Luke ride on the Falcon.
I think
change
it's just
the whole destiny of the ship.
I'm gonna be.
I think every good decision
that
the Falcon has made is because Chewie was part of it, and everything that went awry.
I'm gonna get.
It's because Han got to.
I'm gonna get pragmatic, and I'm gonna say that. The reason why we don't talk a lot about Chewie and the Falcon in that kind of way, where it's his narrative story linked to it, is because there's only so much they do with Chewie. Like, Chewie roars and shoots stuff, but, you know, they don't really do a lot of narrative things with Chewie. Like, Chewie is the faithful sidekick. He's the faithful sidekick.
He's the big badass.
Question, is he the faithful sidekick to Han Solo or the faithful sidekick to the Millennium Falcon? Is he really the Falcon sidekick?
Well, George conceived of Chewbacca as his dog sitting next to him in his car.
Yeah, a man and his dog.
So, maybe.
So if Chewie and the Falcon are sort of one piece together, which is kind of, I mean, I know I don't want to say that because Chewie's his own person.
It's like,
but if Chewie's...
That's why Chewie didn't get a medal in A New Hope, because
no,
they're like, the Wookiee,
saying,
the Wookiee's the crew.
I'm saying...
He's the doorman.
I'm saying that, like, okay, if he's Han's dog,
he's
and
not
then
Han's dog. He's
you,
Han's life...
Life friend.
Hetero life mate.
Yes, he is. But, it, okay, but also if he is Han's hetero life mate dog, okay? Let's just talk about this way. Then the idea that Han dies and the Falcon gets passed to Rey, is Chewie even passed to Rey as well? Like, adoption-wise? Like, Rey has adopted Chewie or Chewie has adopted her? And, you know, and that, it's always so funny because you forget that Chewie's, like, older than everybody here.
Chewie.
He's just standing around going, I'm too old for this stuff.
Chewie owed Han a life debt. Okay?
Yes.
So after Han dies, hypothetically,
his life debt's over.
His life debt's over. I don't think life debt rolls into your next of kin.
Ben Solo. Well, he shot him.
Leia
so.
And and Ben.
Yeah.
That's Chewie. Poor Chewie.
I know,
he's
right?
He's always in this
See?
Marginalized
exactly.
middle place.
See, so when you talk
where
about
he doesn't get full autonomy.
When we talk about the Falcon, it's kind of hard to
maybe
put him in
it's
like that.
Like. Maybe it's a Kashyyyk, you know, Wookiee thing.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I'm not gonna wear pants. I don't believe in pants. I have one sash that represents my culture and my history.
Uh-huh.
No one owns anything, okay?
Uh-huh.
Everything belongs to all of us.
He got those bandoliers from...
So he doesn't
want
to have ownership.
But he got those bandoliers from Val and company in Solo.
Well, I'm talking about old mythology.
Oh, okay.
Old mythology, his one bandolier
well,
was part of his... Kashyyyk history, and in freaking Revenge of the Sith, he has one bandolier.
Yeah, it, well,
he has one bandolier.
In Solo,
he went back to his OG outfit.
Yeah, he did. In Solo, A Star Wars Story, he got it from Val and Beckett.
Yeah, he was trying his new hip style.
His hip style.
He's like, this guy's got a cape. I gotta compete somehow. Bandoliers.
Yeah, I guess that is sort of the lingering question about the Falcon and Chewie, and we do have to wonder. But it almost. If I want to look at this in a way that I talk about Chewie in my head canon, it kind of feels like for Chewie, what matters is the people in the ship and not the ship itself.
Maybe it's this.
And no, I'm serious. And he serves the people in the ship. And because Han's last wishes were to protect Rey and to help Rey and to help Finn and to help the Resistance, that is what Chewie's continuing on to do. You know what I mean?
He's so noble. This
he
boy.
Is. I
this
think Chewie is
dog.
A really noble...
No,
he
I,
is. He's
I,
loyal. He's a loyal space
I,
puppy. He is.
I want to think that after Han dies,
mm-hmm.
the life debt Han died
mm-hmm.
wanting to bring his son back to the light side.
But then...
And Chewbacca feels like, I got to stick with the story to see what happens to this kid.
Well, yeah. But then how do you
I'm
going to
stick around.
He almost ended the story by shooting him in the gut.
I've been in 60 years of Star Wars gossip. I'm not going to get out of the loop now and have C-3PO telling
me
I'm
but
stupid.
But he shot Ben Solo, like, super hard.
Yeah. But he
but
shot
was,
him in the leg. He didn't shot him in the face.
He shot him in the side.
Yeah, but he didn't shoot him in the face.
That's true. He could have shot him in
Dude,
the face.
Dude, you could have headshot it and maybe...
There's a wonderful comic...
If a shot to a stormtrooper's chest can make a stormtrooper fly across the room...
That's true.
A headshot would have popped Ben Solo's...
head like a grape, yeah.
Come on.
And Ben Solo deflected some of that power with his force powers, by the way.
From a wrestling perspective...
But he did, you know that.
Yeah.
Okay.
From a wrestling perspective...
Uh-huh.
That bowcaster kind of, foreshadows Han Solo's death. Because the bowcaster was Chewbacca's gimmick for so long. And then right before Han Solo's death, Han Solo's allowed to play with Chewbacca's gimmick.
Oh, of course, yeah.
And shoot it around. And then from that point on, Han's gimmick, the Falcon, is passed over to Chewbacca.
Brilliant, you're right.
So maybe it's a Wookiee, like, trading thing? He's like, I lent you my gun. Now you owe me shit forever.
There's one more digression. There's a wonderful comic that sort of illustrates what may have been going through Chewie's head when he shot Ben.
No.
And it's like a series of little images of him playing with baby Ben Solo, and then seeing him get angrier and trying to comfort him, but he can't comfort him. And then that moment that he kills Han, Chewie gets so angry, and he goes to aim for his head, but then he can't do it, so he aims for his side.
And I gotta put a link in the episode.
Yeah, put a link, because I love that comic. I'm sorry. I love that comic. I don't know who the artist is. I'll credit. We'll put the artist's link there. Anyway, so, but back to the Falcon. I think we're good to talk about maybe the future of the Falcon. What we think. I know we've kind of briefly touched on this idea, like, for 9 predictions and things like that, but... Like, what do you think? So, do you think it's going to continue? Okay, here's a good question. Not even about 9. Do you think the Falcon will continue on after the sequel trilogy's over? Do you think they'll find a way in Rian Johnson's trilogy, in Benioff and Weiss's trilogy? Do you think they're going to have the Falcon with somebody else?
I got to imagine that just, like, everything that isn't tied to someone's face specifically...
Mm-hmm. It's
fair game.
Yeah.
For anything else, seeing as how the Millennium Falcon is going to be a huge part of the Star Wars, Disneyland and Disney World experience, I would say that it'll never get the sort of like A plus screen time that it does in a saga film.
Yeah.
But it'll still get some. You know, some homages, some references, but it'll never get that. Be the main ship of a series if it's not the Skywalker series.
Do you think that they would destroy the Falcon in 9?
I think it's very, very likely that the Falcon boom booms or crash crashes in some way.
Mm-hmm.
Like,
I know
one of the biggest moments
of
the Star Trek film franchise is when they're ready to blow up an Enterprise.
Yeah.
So the fact that Star Wars hasn't gone to that well yet, I think it's only a matter of time until the ship gets broken in half and repaired.
Maybe part of like a big climax or something is something to do with the Falcon. Maybe, you know, who knows? We've talked about this before, how I would love if Ben flew the Falcon, like, and repaired the Falcon.
On our episode, 4
yeah.
Things I Want in episode 9. You can check
yes.
it out on the feed right
and
here.
And so I've talked about that.
We're still
yeah.
open to talk about us. If you want to email us, rebelorderpod@gmail.com or tweet us @rebelorderpod. Make sure to follow us and subscribe to us. Ads.
Oh.
We didn't have a plug yet.
Yeah, you're right. No, yeah, so... I guess I'm saying this to kind of wrap it up just because I love the Falcon as a ship so much. And I think in the world of Star Wars, it is such a unique thing. It represents Star Wars so well that I'm sort of like wondering, like, you know, obviously.
Duke, I agree. The Falcon is cool.
You know, we have to wonder, like... You know, at some point it's gotta go. Like, it can't run for another 100 years. If they set any of these trilogies in the future, it can't be 300 years old. At some point, a ship's gotta go out of commission, guys.
No,
I'm wrong.
As long as it turns a profit,
you live forever.
As long as it can smuggle in a profit, the Falcon will fly.
I'm wondering if maybe that's one of the reasons too they put it in Galaxy's Edge. Well, one, because everyone loves the Millennium Falcon, but two, because if they can't use it in the movies because the story sort of told on it, at least they'll tell you, well, you can always see the Falcon, visit Galaxy's Edge at Disneyland and Disney World.
And the whole purpose of that Falcon ride is that there supposedly is over 200 buttons you can press.
Yeah.
And that each of those buttons will change your simulated Falcon experience. And that based on what you do navigationally,
mm-hmm.
you could either smuggle your wares perfectly... Or crash your ship into the dirt or whatever. Like, there's
so
a wide range of possibilities.
Question.
The Falcon is a phoenix.
Do they have their
okay.
own Kobayashi Maru scenario going on in there?
Maybe. Yeah. Maybe a no-win scenario. But they said you could win if you press the buttons right. So.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. Well, I think we've
the
done
the Falcon
a good
is a phoenix.
Yeah.
It is a symbol of hope.
Oh.
It's a symbol of rebirth. And now, at the end of The Last Jedi, it is the only thing carrying the leadership of the Resistance away. It is literally the Resistance flagship.
It is the Resistance, yeah, exactly.
It is the flagship of the Resistance at
absolutely
this point.
Absolutely, 100%.
Chewbacca just made Jedi. What's
it? It's true. It is. It has really become the ultimate symbol of the rebellion, of freedom, of individual freedoms, of... you know, of just helping out everyone, of helping out the little guy. Every light-sided thing you could think of, the Falcon has become that.
One last strange little weird Steven theory to end the show.
Oh, please, I want to hear it.
When you were saying that Ben Solo wanted to be a pilot like his father.
Yes.
It made me think.
Mm-hmm.
What if what he said, when Ben Solo says, I want to finish what Vader started,
mm-hmm.
maybe he meant, I want to go back to Tatooine and build a pod racer and pilot and win a pod race just like Vader, my grandfather, Anakin, did.
You've done it. You've solved the whole
thing.
That's
trilogy. The end of episode 9.
That's the controversial
pod race for the galaxy.
Nine.
Boom.
There you go. He goes back in time. He goes to little Annie, and he says, I'll take it from here.
You get to stay a slave.
Adam Driver in a pod racer.
Versus Annie.
I'm pretty sure that if they had done that, Adam Driver would have quit on the set that day.
It would be amazing, too, if like they...
he would have left.
They re-edited, right?
Yeah.
To that original pod racer footage. And then you just see, like, Kylo zooming past Anakin, and you just see, like, the dub, and it's, instead of saying yippee, it's like, nopey.
Wow. Okay. Yeah. Thank you guys so much for listening. We hope we entertained you and informed you and
we hope we made
stimulated
up for
your brain. And
I hope we made up for our absence last week with this bigger, meatier edition of our hamburger-styled spaceship.
As Steven said previously, please tweet us at Rebel Order Pod.
Oh, the one thing we didn't say.
Oh, I'm sorry. What?
Before I don't think we didn't say it.
What?
But there's this urban myth about the Millennium Falcon.
Oh, the
that
myth!
George Lucas,
the myth!
That George Lucas basically started as, like, an easy, you know, condensed version of, like, a little soundbite to have about the creation of the Falcon.
Mm-hmm.
Where there's this urban myth that George was eating a hamburger, flying back to London, and they put an olive on a toothpick on the hamburger, and he looked at it and took a bite of it and then said, that's what a spaceship looks like, and that's where the Falcon's signature shape and dish.
It actually made it into the making of Star Wars books. So it's a pretty big myth story, but
and people love to push it because it's like just a nice
because it's easy.
It's fun to think of the Falcon as like it's something so American. It's a hamburger. Come on.
As American as apple pie and cheeseburger.
And the Star Destroyer has a flying pizza, don't you know?
Oh my goodness. So thank you again, as I said. And please tweet us at Rebel Order Pod, or you can email us at rebelorderpod@gmail.com.
Correct. So. And I was hoping that next show, Captain Danny,
yes,
I would like to ask you this question, and maybe our listeners can write in and we can talk about it next week.
Mm-hmm.
In Return of the Jedi.
Mm-hmm.
When Yoda says, there is another.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think that maybe he had a vision about not just Leia having the Force, but about her whole timeline, her son, everything else? Let us know.
We'll talk about it next week.
Next week, Rebel Order Podcast. Punch it! Ow! That's my face. So designed the Falcon into the shape that we now lovingly know.
Space 1990. Wow. No, I'm saying, I'm laughing because I can only imagine what they thought space in 1999 was going to look at. And
it was going to look like the Phantom Four, obviously.
And I hate to disappoint them. The people who are still alive who made that show must have looked around like, oh no.
What's ironic is that by 1999, you'd have the Phantom Four. So that's what space really looks like.
It's always just so funny to me how so much of before the sort of influx of technology has been out there, before the kind of revolutionary technology, human beings had such an optimistic viewpoint of the future. For the most part, obviously dystopian novels existed, but they had such an optimistic version of by 2000 we'll have flying cars and and now we're all just it'll be if we are still here and the land that we're living on isn't in the ocean. We're just can we just
survive?
Can we just survive till 2080? It's gonna be okay. But,
so I'll edit that, put that at the end of the show.
Thank the maker.
You're so right.